How's everybody doing this morning? Good. Apparently, I enjoy potted meat. So says canned meat and other various things. I don't know who writes this garbage, but I need to have a word with them. Has everybody enjoyed their spring break or lack thereof? Looks like everybody's still enjoying spring break, but we're happy that you're here this morning. And hey, as we look forward throughout the month of April, I know I talked about it a little bit last week, but this month's big give, we're going to do a baby shower for some needy mothers in our community, and that's being headed up by Laura Ridley, and she was here in the first service, and I just want to pass this message to you from Laura that, of course, we need your generosity when we talk about getting diapers and wipes and things for children. But what we really need for these mothers is just some ladies that are willing to mentor and kind of teach these ladies what it is to be a mother and be a part of a family. So if you feel like God's called you to maybe even just spend one lunch with these ladies a month, to just sit down with them and kind of talk to them about what it means to be a mother, please tell Will or Tim or Laura Ridley, and we'd really appreciate it. But we're going to continue to collect diapers and wipes until end of April, and then the baby shower will be on April 27th. So if that's something you'd like to be a part of, please let us know. And then if you're new to Oak Leaf or you have a friend that's been coming to Oak Leaf that would like to learn a little bit more about the mission and the vision of this church, on May 5th at 6 o'clock, we're going to do Discover Oak Leaf again, just to be a time to be in this room with Will and some of the other pastors and just talk about the history of the church and then, of course, the future of this church as well. And child care will be provided. Let's pray. Father, I just have one very simple request this morning as we meet in this room with this group of people, Lord, and that is that that you would just meet with us in this place, Lord, over the next hour, Lord, that we could just push all our daily cares aside, Lord, all the troubles that we're facing, anything that might be going on in our life right now, and just solely focus on you as our King, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Joy and in excited about today. Nothing else to celebrate. We have Christ is risen. He's defeated the grave. He brought peace and joy to our hearts. So we just sing that this morning. Let nobody in sin remain. We'll sing it with me.
Let no one caught in sin remain inside the lie of inward shame. We fix our eyes upon the cross and run to Him who showed great love and bled for us. He's freely bled. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with Him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave.
Have a seat. Have a seat. Man, love that song. Absolutely love it. Well, every week we provide an opportunity for people to give back, and that's what this is—a time, our time of giving. And I want to preemptively thank you for everything that Billy was talking about in the big give this April, with the bringing in the diapers and the wipes. It's going to be a huge help to these girls who have very, very little, who have no real concept of family, of relationships, of marriage, And in the first service, and I know Billy said something about it during the welcome, but in the first service, Laura was just talking about, she's heading the whole thing up, was talking about how she's begun to meet with these girls. It's about six of them. The young, expectant mothers in need. And she's beginning to take them out to lunch. And she recognized, much like we did this last year, much like when we helped these girls, they ultimately need like someone in their life pouring into them. And I know that some women are going to step up from the first service and this service, some women who aren't here, who have just a little bit of time to give. And that's an act of generosity as well. And maybe you can't give diapers or wipes, but you can give a lunch date or a phone call or a handwritten letter to reach out to someone who might not have much family at all, to just remind them that God loves them, that we love them, that God wants the absolute best for them, just as he wants for everyone. And I say all that because as we're talking about it through the whole month of April, it's going to be fantastic. And as you have been in the past generous, I know that you will continue to be generous through this particular big give. And I'm asking you to come and volunteer with big inflatables, anything crazy. I know a lot of some of the guys in here are like, I don't get it, you know, babies. I don't want anything to do with it, you know. I'm glad my kids are out of diapers, right? You're beyond that stage. But just to know that anything that you do, any time you give, any prayers you pray, any money you give or diapers, wipes, whatever you bring in, it just only helps us continue to help others. It only helps us continue to reach out in the community, help those in need. And so it's a good relationship with Focus Cherokee, and we hope a long-standing relationship with these girls as we share and show the love of Jesus. So I'm thanking you for your generosity already. Love to see that thing overflow. Love to have to go get another crib or something and fill it up. We can just abundantly bless these girls. But I just want to pray for the service, pray for this time of giving, and pray for you. So let's go before the Lord now. Oh God, you have brought people into this church who have a generous heart, a loving heart. You've brought some of the most generous people I've ever met to help us become, especially in our small size, one of the most generous churches I know of. To be able to do so much outside of this building, which is what it's all about ultimately, to help people see you and recognize you, reveal who you are to others who may not know you well or know you at all. And may you continue to provide opportunities and continue to bless those who trust you in that way. Continue to bless this church as we continue to go out of these walls and bless those around us and bless those in the community that need to have the love of Jesus shown to them, shared with them. I pray for this time of giving. I pray for this service that as we begin this new series today, you will open our hearts to recognize areas in our life that we're still not trusting you, that you will help us defeat doubt and fear and timidity, I don't know how to say the word, but you know what I'm talking about, the shame of not giving you our absolute all. God, may we believe in you wholeheartedly. We give you this time. Pray for you to move among us, whisper into us something that changes us forever. We give this to you, God, and that we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go to John chapter 6 this morning, beginning a brand new series, Body of Evidence. Finding truth between faith and doubt. What we believe and what we doubt. What we're not sure about. What we don't completely trust. If you, I always forget to say this sometimes. If you don't, I just said, I always forget to say this sometimes. All right. If you don't have a Bible this morning, then you're welcome to get up and grab one, or David or someone will give you one. Just raise your hand. They'll bring it to you. You can use it this morning if you didn't bring one. If you don't own a Bible or would like a new one, then it's yours to keep, our gift to you. Those of you who know me, I know some of you in here probably went to high school with me. I know there's several people from North Cobb. I went to North Cobb High School. Woo-hoo, go Warriors. Yeah. And you know that I have a relatively squeaky clean past. Squeaky clean. You like that? All right. His squeak. Never mind. Okay. So I didn't really party much, right? Didn't hang out with people who partied a whole lot. I grew up in church my whole life, right? I don't have one of those testimonies where I was like a part of the mafia and I killed people and I did drugs 20 times a day. And I don't have a testimony like that. I'm relatively boring in that regard. But I did get arrested once. Have I told you that story?
Yeah.
All right, here we go. I did get arrested once. I got arrested for rolling our school. Oh, this is a true story. It's a true story. Listen, you're going to like this. But don't do this, okay? Just hear the story and learn the lesson that I learned. Okay, here's what happened. We got to go all the way back to, okay, my wife, she was a year ahead of me, and her junior year, the juniors and seniors played every year, they played a powder puff game where the girls play football, and it was a big tradition, and everybody looked forward to it. Freshmen and sophomores just had to watch, and so obviously we were looking forward to playing that game. Well, her year, the seniors and juniors got into like a brawl, like a fist fight, and so when it came time for us to do the powder puff game, my junior year, her senior year, they canceled it. They canceled it. Well, we were kind of mad, all right? There were a lot of people who were kind of upset. There was another tradition where the seniors ate in the senior courtyard area outside of the lunchroom. And the at the end of the year when the seniors were kind of not in class because they were practicing graduation and taking exams, the juniors would take over the senior courtyard because no one's there. So the night before that transition, the seniors would come and demolish it. They would cover with eggs and tip over all the concrete tables and really mess it up. So if the juniors wanted to sit out there, they'd have to clean it up. And it happened every year. Everybody's used to it. Yada, yada. No big deal. Okay. Well, this year, because the powder puff game was canceled, the seniors came to juniors, like some of the senior leadership came to the junior leadership and said, hey, listen, we're not going to demolish the senior courtyard. What we want to do is we want to demolish the whole school, okay? We want out of revenge for the whole powder puff thing. We want to take it to the whole school, and we want to know if you're in with us. And so this became a really like a big deal. Like there were like I'm telling you like dozens like there was everybody was talking about it. Like even some of the assistant principals that didn't agree with the whole canceling the powder puff game. Like heard about it and said, hey, listen, I know what you guys are planning, but I'm not going to tell you not to do it, all right? I'm just going to pretend like I didn't hear about it, okay? And so it was like fueling this flame, and this big group of people were so excited about what they were coming, so much so that the principal called a special emergency meeting, and he called in the student body president, student body vice president, senior class president, junior class president, all these people, brought them to his office and said, hey, I hear something is being planned, all right? And I know that you're upset about the canceling of the powder puff game. It's bigger than what you think it is. I know I probably can't stop what you're doing. I'm just going to ask you to not destroy the school, please. Like he was like, don't do anything. And I'm like, I can't stop these people from this. It's not us. We're not planning this. He's like, okay, well, then tell your friends to not bring eggs. If it's just toilet paper, it's fine, okay? Don't bring eggs, don't bring paint, don't wreck things. That costs money, that costs time. Toilet paper and cleanup, that's no big deal, okay? Can you do that? Can you at least do that? Well, so now student government, at least in their minds, had gotten permission from the principal to roll the school. I mean, that's what he said. He's like, toilet paper is fine. They didn't hear, they heard, no eggs, no violence, no spray paint, but you can use toilet paper. You can use toilet paper. That's all they heard. So we had a meeting after school, and I was there, and there were dozens of kids there. And so here's the student body president and the senior class president, junior class president. They're like, hey guys, listen, we are going to roll the school. We have the principal's permission, okay? You're going to come. Here's the night. We're going to do it. We're going to meet here at 1 o'clock in the morning. We're going to roll the school. Bring as much toilet paper. Bring as many people as you want. It's going to be awesome. And it was awesome. All right, so I went with the group. I was okay. I had a friend that lived about a mile from the school. So I didn't do these kind of things regularly. So I didn't really plan this thing out. Right, we parked at his house, and so he was student body president, and then some other friends. So like the next year's senior class president, the next year's junior class president. Those are the people that I was hanging out with. That was my group. And so we're walking from Bert was his name. We're walking from Bert's house to North Cobb, and they were like, there's 135 kids out there, and they all have just loads of toilet paper. All right? Now, this isn't like five kids jump out of a van and like throw two things over a tree. I'm telling you, this was like a coordinated attack. All right? Like, we had split up, and it was like we were flanking all sides of the school, and I'm telling you, in a matter of minutes, it looked like it had snowed, people. It was amazing. It was incredible. It was incredible. We covered the entire front of the school. And if you know where North Cobb is, coming down Old 41, we covered the entire front of the school. We went down the side of the school where the bus alley was. We had the whole school covered with toilet paper. It was amazing. All the trees out front, it was gorgeous. It was the great. It was one of the greatest things I've ever seen. Unbelievable. Well, some people who were not invited to the party, some alumni from the year before, probably the people who started the whole Powder Puff fight thing, showed up. Well, they didn't get the memo about no eggs and no violence, because they showed up in their Jeep and they start throwing eggs out of their Jeep. Well, they happen to hit somebody who doesn't like to get hit with an egg. And so he runs to the Jeep and he grabs a golf club out of the back of the Jeep and he starts swinging at somebody, and he hits somebody who doesn't like to get hit with a golf club. And next thing you know, there's a fight, all right? And next thing you know, somebody is running to a payphone and dialing payphones. Y'all remember those things? It's like a... like a little thing on a wall. It's like it's got buttons, and you call people. You put money in it, and you call. Anyway, so he runs to the payphone, and he dials 911. And so we hear people shouting, the cops are coming, the cops are coming, the cops are coming. Okay, everybody else parked on campus. We parked a mile away. So we're walking down the road. The police are coming on, okay? We're walking down the sidewalk, down Old 41. We're not walking, we're running. And we see these headlights coming over this hill. And we don't know if it's a cop or if it's just somebody up at 3 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning. And so we stop, and we're all walking. And sure enough, it was a cop who passed by. And he screeched to a halt, and he comes back. He makes a stir. Some people, they were scared. We were scared for our lives. Listen, we were not, like, we were the good kids. We were the ones who never got in trouble. And, like, a couple of the kids were so freaked out that they were going to find their parents are going to, like, ground them for life. They literally jumped in the woods and hid there till morning. I'm not making this up. So we walk back to the school, and everyone else is, they're gone, right? Everyone's gone. 135 kids disappeared in a flash, except us, who geniusly parked a mile away, okay? And another group of a couple cars that jumped in their cars quickly and drove to a gas station to buy eggs to come back and fight. So as they were pulling into the parking lot, the cops came in right after them, and they were stuck. That was it. Everybody else was gone, all right? And here's the school, man, it's gorgeous. I remember walking back going, oh, wow, we're in so much trouble. Oh, this is so bad. And so we're sitting in the little parking lot area. And my company, the group that I was with, senior class president, senior class vice president, next year's junior class president, this next year's student body president, and the principal, they called the principal. We had to call our parents. They all short of handcuffing us, because they didn't have enough handcuffs. They had us all sit down on our hands in circles and apart from each other. And they called the principal. The principal showed up at 3 o'clock, and he gets out and he looks at our group. I mean, he's looking at like the people who promised that this wouldn't happen. And I mean, you could just tell he was not happy. And so he convinced them not to take us to jail. They were going to take us to jail for vandalism. We were going to spend the night in jail. It was awful. And so he convinced them to not do this. So they gave us this all these tickets, this fine, whatever. We had to go to court. And had community service, 40 hours of community service had to do. It was crazy. So we went to court, and as we're getting ready to walk in, the prosecutor comes out. And the prosecutor, now, I don't know if any of you guys have ever been to court, but the court's intimidating. Whether you got to stand in front of a judge and say guilty or not guilty, that's an intimidating place, right? And this prosecutor, she comes out. My mom was there, and she was in the last service, and so she was just nodding because she remembers this. The prosecutor comes out, and the prosecutor says, "Now listen, the evidence against you guys, it is overwhelming. I mean, you all did it, right?" And we were like, "Well, yeah. And we were all caught kind of red-handed. Well, you're going to go in. See, it's done, right? The evidence is overwhelming. You're going to go in. What's going to happen? They're going to call your name up. You're just going to plead guilty because you're guilty, right? You all did it." And we're like, "You can't plead not guilty. So you're going to, they're going to go. You're going to plead guilty, and you're going to pay your fine, and you're going to go on your merry way." So we walk in, and they call us up into groups of three. In the first group of three, sure enough, they call the name, guilty, next person, guilty, next person, guilty. All right, they go over there and pay your fine. They go to the next group. I'm in the next group. First person says guilty. Next person says, I would like to plead my case. And the judge just rolls his eyes. What? It's like the principal gave us permission. The judge, excuse me? I find that very hard to believe. So here I am thinking that, like, I've watched Matlock enough to know what I'm supposed to do, right? So I'm like, excuse me, Your Honor, actually, he didn't give us permission. He just said that we could roll the school as long as we just use toilet paper. So he gave you permission. No, Your Honor, I'm trying to, like I'm using the lingo and stuff I watch on TV. No, Your Honor, he didn't give us permission. He just said not to use eggs that we could use. So he gave you permission. No, not technically. He didn't say like we could go roll it. He just said that he didn't mind the toilet paper. He just didn't want anything else. And we were the ones, you know, there were 135 people there. We were just the ones that were caught. It's like, you're telling me that your principal told you specifically that he didn't mind toilet paper. And we're like, yeah, that's exactly right. We're all nodding, yeah. He's like, well, then why in the world are you pleading guilty? And I turned around and said, because that lady right there said we had to. She probably lost her job after that. Anyway, so he leans forward in his desk. He's like, listen to me. He's like, if this is true, your principal has said that it was okay to use toilet paper, right? Then that is condemning on his part. And nobody can tell you to plead guilty. You have to decide for yourself. And if I were you, I would plead not guilty. I can't give you legal advice. I'm just telling you that if the principal told you it was okay, you should plead not guilty. So the first person in my little group with me said, okay, not guilty. Next person, not guilty. I was like, not guilty. And the first three were like, whoa, time out. We got to fix it. We want to change our plea. So just like, all right, let's do it. So everybody's now not guilty. And they get a court date. It was funny because the seniors, they were out of school by this time because it was during the summer. And they were just like, oh, this is going to be great. They were pulling out like pocket change. And they subpoenaed everyone. I mean, I think they subpoenaed like the superintendent of Cobb County. They subpoenaed everyone to come back and put them all on the stand. I mean, they were like planning this thing out. Like, we're going to do this right. We're going to get off of this. We're not going to pay this fine. We're not going to have this on our record, yada, 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 yada. And so we came back several months later, came back, same basic deal, except when the prosecutor came out this time, the prosecutor says, okay, so the prince, nobody showed up. None of the people who were subpoenaed showed up. And the prosecutor came out and said, okay, so here's what's going to happen. We're just going to close the case. We think you guys have learned your lesson, all right? We think that everything is you served, you know, community service thing, time served. So it's technically called no pros, but that just means that you don't have to worry about it. Everything is taken care of. So I go home, and this is like pre-Google, and I had to like look it up in an actual encyclopedia. But no pros means no prosecution. It means they had no case. It means the evidence had changed, and they realized that they had nothing to press. The principal had said we could roll the school. And the evidence that was skewed one way originally and said you are guilty, there's no option, you have to do it. There was new evidence, or the evidence had come to light that had changed it. The perspective of the evidence had changed enough for the judge to say you should plead not guilty. You know, the worst part about the whole story, it was great, we got off, it was phenomenal, it was fantastic. The worst part about the whole story was the principal made us clean it up that morning before we left, like before school, so no one saw it. And there was no camera phones. There's no evidence of it. It was the greatest rolling of all time, and no one will ever know about it, except the story I'm telling you right now. So sad. It'd have been, man, we'd have blown Twitter up. Let me tell you something. 3 o'clock in the morning. All right. So the body of evidence is what we draw our conclusions. And in a courtroom, you've got the defense, you got the prosecution. And the role of the defense is to present the evidence in such a way that they are acquitted. The prosecution is going to present the evidence in such a way that they are found guilty, right? That it could be the same evidence, But they are going to spin it and skew it. They're going to do everything they can. They're going to ask questions a certain way. They're going to present it in a certain light to point you in the direction they want you to go. And you can think about if you've ever watched 48 Hours, if you keep up with like the Trayvon Martin case or any high profile case, or like when O.J. Simpson was on trial, you probably had an opinion about it up front. But the more evidence came out, the more they talked about stuff, you'd be maybe on the fence. Like, I don't know, I'm not sure. I said he was guilty, but now I don't know. Now, some people are hardcore on the defense, like, absolutely not guilty, no way. And some people are hardcore, absolutely guilty. Oh, yeah, absolutely did it. But that on the fence, that I don't know, that's extremely dangerous. That's probably the most dangerous place to be in because it's filled with doubt. It's filled with unbelievable uncertainty, right? And this is the question that I'm going to ask you today that we're going to ask you the whole series, really. But and when we're thinking about Jesus, when we're thinking about the evidence that he presented and what he did and what he said, you have to ask yourself, do you believe or do you doubt? Now, knee jerk, you're going to say, well, of course I believe. But do you really believe? We're going to look here in just a second. We're going to see some people that should believe, but they doubt. The smallest little hint, right? What they say, you've heard the term beyond reasonable doubt. The smallest little hint of doubt can throw a case, right? Because if someone's on the fence just a little bit and they can't be 100% not guilty or 100% guilty, it messes the whole thing up. Well, and when we're talking about our eternal state, our eternal being, right? The fulfillment of life now. We are for Jesus, absolutely surrender, trusting 100%. Yes, Jesus is God. That's his defense. That's his opening statement. We read that last week. Jesus' opening statement is, I am God. All right? Believe that, there is life. Don't believe me, and the consequences are severe. That's his opening statement. Thank you very much. And he sat down. That's it. That's pretty much what he said. I am God. Believe that. If you don't believe that, you're in trouble. Thank you. And so there, you side with him 100%, or you say completely against it. Like, I don't believe in God. I don't believe in Jesus. I don't believe the Bible. I don't believe anything. I'm 100% against him. It's all a joke. It's all irrelevant. But then it's the people in the middle. Like, well, I don't know, man. I mean, this is good. I like this, but I don't like this. I'm kind of on the fence. Well, listen, on the fence has the same eternal consequences as completely against God. Not completely trusting him, you might as well be completely against him. Because doubt is not from God. Uncertainty is not from God. The spin is the devil. So we're going to look at some body of evidence today and see if we side with Jesus or if we side with the world. So this is a very famous story. If you've been in church at any point in your life, you've probably heard this story. Jesus feeding 5,000. All right, so we're going to read that. I'm going to read it straight through, and then we're going to talk about it a little bit. So let's start in chapter 6, verse 1. After Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick, Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Now, the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes then and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, filled the 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world. Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. All right, let's just break a little bit of this down. All right, this miracle is the only miracle mentioned in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, other than the resurrection. It's the only one. That's significant. That means that is a large-scale miracle. This isn't healing one person. This is doing something miraculous to lots of people. Now it says, and because it's in all four Gospels, you really got to read all four of them to get the whole picture. There's clues in each one that talk about where the boy came from, and talk about what time of year it was, what they did with the people, how they sat them down in groups. And so you put all that together and you get the whole picture. And so 5,000 men, it says 5,000 men, but in other passages it talks about the women and the children. That number doesn't include the women and children. So many scholars believe the number could have been upwards of 20,000 people total, men, their wives, and their kids. Because a lot of these families weren't like the American husband, wife, and one child, two children. This is husband, wife, and like 23 kids. Not just the Duggar families, a whole bunch of Duggar families, okay? I don't know that for sure, but they were big families, all right? But it doesn't matter. 20,000, 15 to 20,000 people, that's the estimate of most scholars. And so he's going to feed all of them. Now listen, I don't know how long it would take. Like if I had truckloads of bread to actually break up, no miracle, just breaking up bread to feed 20,000 people, how long that would take me, right? But he had five loaves, small loaves, barley loaves. Barley, this is not wheat. Wheat is what you would buy if you had the money. Barley is what you had if you scraped up something, you were poor. That was the cheap bread, okay? So he had five tiny little barley loaves about this big and two fish, sardine, like pickled fish, small little tiny fish. And the dude broke it and spread it out and fed 20,000 people till they were full and had 12 baskets left over. That is amazing. That is a miracle. Now, John only talks about seven miracles in the entire book, and this is one of them. Seven signs and wonders. And to do this in front of 20,000 people, that's why it's in all four Gospels. You can't ignore this. This is huge. This is 20,000 people, men, women, and children, who witnessed this amazing sign. So much so that when they saw it and they recognized what he had done, they saw him as the prophet. That's what it says in verse 14. This indeed, the prophet who is to come into the world. That's what Moses said, that God will send, the Father will send a prophet. He will send his son. He will send the Messiah. And they recognize it and say, this must be him. And so they're ready to make him king. They're ready to put him on a throne. They're ready to claim him as king of the Jews, because that's what the prophet would be that Moses talked about. But Jesus withdrew to the mountain because remember we talked about this a couple weeks ago, that many saw the signs he did and they believed in him, but he didn't entrust himself to them. Why? Because he knew their heart. He knew that they didn't really believe. So they're mesmerized by this incredible miracle of breaking bread and fish and feeding 15, 20,000 people. But Jesus leaves because he doesn't need the throne. He doesn't need the title king. That's not the reason he's doing this. This is actually foreshadowing to the message that he's going to give for the rest of the book of John. And we're going to read it in the next couple weeks about him saying he's the bread of life. Jesus is saying, he said it at the woman at the well, I give you water so you don't thirst anymore. This is, I will give you bread so you don't hunger anymore. I will satisfy your every need. I will take care of you. You need nothing but me. I am it. And this is a setup for several things he's going to talk about in the next couple weeks. We'll look at it. Foreshadowing. But the people missed the bigger message of trusting him. They just want to make him king, and that's not what he wants. He still has to pay the price on the cross. He has, therefore, a specific duty. So, great story. Little boy, five loaves of bread, two fish. That's not what I want to talk about. I actually want to talk about what happened before, like the doubt set in by the disciples. The miracle is great. But look at verse 5. Jesus said to Philip, he said, where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat? And Philip said, what, 200 denarii would not buy even enough bread for each of them to eat, get a little? How much is 200 denarii? Anybody know? One denarii is a day's wages. Okay? Now, like, Cokes didn't cost $2, all right, back then, right? But one denarii is a day's wage. So 200 denarii is 200 days' wage. You're talking about 8 months' wages in his fanny pack, right? I don't know who walks around with 8 months' wages in a satchel. Walking around, not me, right? Cash and a little neon glowing fanny pack. 8 months' wages. And it wasn't enough to buy bread to feed all these people, even a little. Now, here's what Philip's saying. Philip's saying, hey, we got 200 denarii in our pocketbook, in our man bag. And I don't even know if there's enough bread around us to feed this crowd. It's 20,000 people. Let alone, we couldn't afford it because we only got 200 denarii. We couldn't buy it all. And then, even if we did buy it, we'd be left with no money. Well, what are we going to buy our dinner with tomorrow? Jesus? Now, Philip was there when he saw Jesus turn water to wine. He was there when he saw the invalid healed. He was there when Jesus healed the official's son. Those are the signs we see in John, but there are dozens of other signs and wonders, healings, miracles that Jesus performed that Philip would have been there and witnessed with his own eyeballs and seen, and here he is saying, we don't have enough money, we can't do that, to the guy who has done it before. Now, I think it's fascinating that Jesus did not divide the money and like make it from 200 denarii to like 2 million denarii. Boom, there you go, guys. Woo! Won the lottery. Check your fanny pack now. Mm-hmm. Like the pulling in the fish. It's like, oh, wait, all of a sudden it's really heavy. I can't hold it anymore. Or he's just breaking the bread. He's breaking the coins. Like, oop, five more denarii. Oh, what's behind your ear? Oh, denarii. You're like, oh, money everywhere. He could have done that, right? He could have totally had plenty. This is not enough money to buy, to get everybody even just a little bit of bread. And Jesus could have said, poof, check your bag again. Booyah, millions of denarii. But he didn't do that. Because that's not the statement, right? It's not the money. And then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, they've got five loaves of bread, two fish. And Andrew goes, here's a boy's got five loaves of bread and two fish. But what is he says, but what are they for so many? Again, this guy was there when he said, toss the net over the boat and draw in the fish. This guy was there. He was there when John the Baptist said, that is the Lamb of God. That is who we are called to follow. Andrew was there, seen all that. He gets it all, and here he is telling the Lamb of God, what are we going to do with five loaves of bread and two fish? That is doubt. That is fear. That is uncertainty. That is not trust in God. Do you see that? They have seen miracles more than most of us, any of us, would ever see in our lifetime, if ever, one miracle. And they've seen dozens, and yet they still, before the one who has done it over and over again, go, what are we going to do with five loaves of bread? We don't have enough money. How are we going to do that? That's not possible. The physics don't work out mathematically. And he does it. And he proves them wrong again. And I love the fact that in verse 11, Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. It says he gave thanks. This is a side note. This is a little rabbit here. But I love the fact that he says he gave thanks. He didn't like ask for a blessing. That's what I do. Like, God, please turn this double cheeseburger into like broccoli as I'm eating it. Pour your blessing of nutrients somehow into this milkshake. It never works. Okay. He gave thanks, because this is what Jesus is saying. God, thank you for something. the smallest, most insignificant nothing, five loaves of bread and two fish, that everybody around me says, it's just worthless. I thank you for that. I thank you for the meaningless scrap that I have to work with. I thank you for that. I thank you for this poor man's bread and this nasty tiny fish. I thank you for that. Now let's do something awesome with it. That's giving thanks. And I think often when we sit down and we think about saying grace or giving thanks, we're not really thanking God for the food and the fact that we have money to buy it or that we have it in front of us to eat, when so many people do not, that we just say it because we say it, or it's just something that we do. And here's Jesus saying, God, thank you for just a little that I know and trust you can turn into a lot. So in the courtroom, in the trial, if Jesus gave his opening statement, I am God, all right, believe me, and you will have life. Don't believe in me, and you'll have death. That's it. Thank you. And he sits down. And the prosecution comes and is like, all right, we talked about witnesses. We got witnesses, but it's just body of evidence. The prosecution pulls up evidence, and he pulls in a bystander. He pulls in Philip up on the witness stand. I call Philip to the witness stand. Prosecutor asked Philip, were you there when Jesus allegedly turned water to wine? Yes, I was. And were you there when he healed the official son? Well, I wasn't actually there where the official was. Just answer the question. Were you there when he healed the official son? No, I was with him when he healed the son. The son was just far away. It was really miraculous. Were you there? Yes. Were you there when he healed the invalid at the pool? Yeah, it was amazing. 38 years that guy had been there. Just answer the question. Were you there? Yes. Yes, I was there. So, why did you doubt he could use the money? What? Well, you saw him turn water to wine. You saw him heal the official son. You saw him heal the invalid. Did you not think that he could use the money? I know. Did you doubt because you really didn't believe? Why did you doubt, Philip? Why did you doubt? I mean, I do believe. No, that's not the question. Why did you doubt this person that you saw do miraculous things? Why did you doubt? I didn't think you could do it. No further questions, Your Honor. Next witness, Andrew. Andrew, you were a disciple of John the Baptist, were you not? Yes, I was. And yet you chose to follow Jesus instead of John the Baptist. Why is that? Well, because John the Baptist has been telling us that he was the predecessor for something greater, and that the Messiah was coming, and I was there with him when he said, behold the Lamb of God. And he pointed out the person we're supposed to be following, and so I've been listening to him, and if Jesus was who we're supposed to follow, I'm going to follow Jesus. So you were a disciple of John the Baptist, and then you chose to follow Jesus because you believed he was greater than John the Baptist. Is that correct? Yes, that's correct. Okay, then why did you doubt that he couldn't do something with the bread and the fish? Could John the Baptist have done the bread and the fish? I don't. Just answer the question. Did you doubt it? Yes. Yes, I did. No further questions, Your Honor. Next witness, a bystander, one of the 20,000. Bystander, were you there? Were you part of the 20,000 people? I was. It was quite a crowd. Were you there when he fed everyone? Were you fed? I was. And you saw him break the bread and the fish? I did. It was miraculous. It was amazing. Okay? And so you saw him do this miraculous thing, and you would call that a miracle. Oh, yeah, definitely. And were you a part of the crowd that claimed him as prophet, that said he was the prophet, the king of the Jews? Everybody was kind of shouting that, and I guess I did. I was a part of the crowd. The crowd shouted that he was the prophet. We wanted to make him king. But were you a part of that crowd? Yes, I was. Okay, so what exactly did you shout at his trial with Pilate? Did you shout king of the Jews? No. What did you shout? Did you shout release him? No. What did you say? Crucify him. Wait, so you're saying that the person that you witnessed break the bread and the fish, that the individual that you claim to be king of the Jews, that you claim to be a prophet, you said crucify him at his trial?
Yes.
Why?
I didn't think he was who he said he was.
No further questions. Cross-examination, right? The defense stands up. Jesus doesn't need an attorney, right? So, Philip, Andrew, bystander, do you believe I am who I say I am? Objection, Your Honor, objection, Your Honor. The witnesses have already, they've already testified to doubting he is who he says he is, right? So for them to now say that they believe would be perjury for the record. But I do believe, I do believe, I do believe. But you said you doubted, so obviously you don't. What evidence will be enough for you to believe 100%? Think about all the things you've got going on. Think about everything in your circumstances, your surroundings. Can you think of one thing in your life, one thing in your life right now that you are not trusting God with? I know I can. I got a list. One thing. Maybe it's an abusive boss, husband, maybe an illness that has affected your family, recent death of a loved one, family member, something like that, an addiction, unforgiveness, a friend, something. Is there something in your life right now, your work, your job, needing to move, not needing to move, change jobs, quit jobs, get married, don't get married, have kids, don't have kids? Is there anything in your life right now that you are not trusting God with? One thing. Because if there is one thing that you can think of right now that you are not trusting God with, and you leave today still worrying about that, still holding on to that, still believing you will eventually figure it out on your own, listen to me. You are not trusting God. You're doubting. You're doubting that he can take care of it. Because listen, you either trust God or you don't. You either believe God can divinely provide your every need or he can't. Which is it? Do you trust him? Do you believe in him or do you doubt? Matt's going to come up. He's going to play. We're going to sing a couple songs before we leave. But that's what you've really got to wrestle with right now in this moment. In fact, what I want you to do is I want you to close your eyes because I want you to concentrate for a second. I want you to take the distractions of the room away, and I want you to think about that one thing. Maybe you got two or three, but let's just pick something right here, right now, that you need to let go of, trust God with, before you leave this room today. And it could be as simple as something at work and dealing with your boss or dealing with a coworker. It'd be something as difficult as an addiction you've wrestled with since you were a teenager. How you treat your kids or how you treat kids that you care for that aren't even yours. Part of a divorce or whatever it is, we got to make it right, right now. We got to give it to God right now. Trust God with it right now. so that we don't leave here today doubting God more or even just the same as we did when we came in. We have got to move from where we are to where God wants us to be, and that means trusting Him more. That means believing Him more so that we wouldn't be put on the stand and said, do you believe? Absolutely. You've trusted God with your life? Absolutely. Well, what about in this moment right here? What about with this friend? What about with this circumstance? Why didn't you go? Why didn't you stay? Why didn't you speak? Why didn't you do what God was asking you to do if you trusted Him? And that is doubt, and that is the devil. Do you believe or do you doubt? Let's believe today. And in this moment, before we sing, I'm going to pray here in just a second. And I want you right where you are right now just to confess it to God and say, this is what I've got to deal with right here, right now. I can't let the burden of this get to me anymore. I've got to lay it at your feet, God. Give you complete control. Trust you with it. Please, God, please. The worry, the pain, the guilt, the anguish, the burning hurt that I deal with on a daily basis because I haven't trusted you with this. I am not, God, I am not going to leave this room until I have given it to you, until I have thrown it away, until I have promised and vowed and swore on my life that I will never worry about it again. Maybe it's finances. Maybe it's debt. Maybe it's a bill that you need to pay, but you don't know where the money's going to come from. And you got to put it away and just say, God, it is on you. Let's trust God today. Let's prove to ourselves that we believe Him, that we're not doubters, that we believe in Him wholeheartedly and who He is and what He's done. And who Jesus is and everything that He said and everything He did was for truth. It was for hope. It was for our own help and eternal life. God, we give it to you right now. And as you're speaking to the individuals here before we sing these songs, as you're moving and speaking, may we have the courage and the boldness and the strength we need to be honest with ourselves and thinking about the stuff that we don't want to bring up. We don't want to admit to because it makes us look ugly. It makes us look dirty. We're in church and these aren't things we're supposed to talk about, but yet you still know them. And there is no better place in the world than here right now with you, with others who are dealing with junk, just like we are, who can pray for us, who can encourage us, who can help us through this. If we will just give it to you, may every single person in this room do that right now. May we believe in you, God. Truly believe. Not just say it. Not just claim the title of Christian, but really believe. And we sing these songs, God, to put our stamp on it. And pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The weight of the world on his shoulders.
sing, we believe.
This morning, if you have that faith this morning that Will talked about, that beyond the shadow of a doubt, you are certain. We have hope and joy and peace that nobody's going to be able to understand or explain. So we sing that this morning, that in Christ alone, and nothing else, that we have our faith. Sing that with me.
In Christ alone. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid. waves of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand.
Church, God, that we stand in your power, in your power alone. We don't depend on anything else but you, God. We just look to you this morning. Thank you.
Amen.